This is the scene tonight. Major plane disaster in Kentucky. A UPS plane crashing near an airport in Louisville.
When tragic aviation accidents happen, soon after the search for survivors, comes the search for the so-called black box. Every commercial plane has them. Companies like GE and Honeywell design them to be nearly indestructible to help investigators understand the cause of a crash.
They're very crucial because it's one of the few sources of information that tells us what happened leading up to the accident.
Microphones in the cockpit also pick up more than pilot conversation.
About 37 seconds after the crew called for takeoff thrust, a repeating bell was heard on the CVR, which persisted until the end of the recording 25 seconds later.
Aircraft have become very complex. A Boeing 787 records thousands of different pieces of information. In the case of the Air India 171 crash in June, the data revealed both engine fuel switches were put into a cutoff position within 1 second of each other. And on the voice recording, a pilot was heard saying, "Why did he cut off?" followed by the other pilot saying he did not.
All of those parameters today can have a very huge impact on the investigation.
This crucial data can also help prevent future accidents. A crash can cost airlines or plane manufacturers hundreds of millions of dollars and leave victims' families with a lifetime of grief, searching for answers that these recorders could provide. But in some circumstances, black boxes haven't been found or were destroyed. And experts say further developments such as cockpit video recorders and real-time data streaming are needed. CNBC explores the evolution of flight data recorders and why airplanes have them. The rate of fatal aviation accidents was far greater in the early days of commercial air travel. And in order to figure out what went wrong, flight data recorders were introduced.
Flight recorders actually go back to the days of the Wright brothers and some of their early designs. As far as what we normally think of black boxes now, the FAA began requiring flight data recorders in the 1950s and cockpit voice recorders in the 1960s. So that's about 70 years of experience using black boxes for accident investigation.
The flight recorder we know today was invented by David Warren in Australia in the 1950s.
In the beginning, it only recorded five parameters, which was at that time, only limited usefulness in accident investigations.
By the 60s, more and more commercial flights began to require them. Originally, the data was recorded onto aluminum foil, then magnetic tape, to today's digital solid-state memory chips.
Today, a lot of the damage to recorders can be tolerated. The unit may not work, but we can go in and get the recording chips inside the box.
The black boxes were painted orange to be more easily found. They were also redesigned and tested to endure incredible forces in order to survive a crash. The memory chips are housed behind a thermal casing, insulation, and a steel or titanium case. They can withstand up to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit for 60 minutes and survive the sea pressure at 20,000 feet under the ocean. It's equipped with an underwater beacon that will ping in seawater for 30 days, with some newer versions up to 90 days in order for investigators to find it.
Pingers all have their limitations. Pinger can be going like crazy at a certain depth where the water is really cold, but then as it travels in the water, it hits an area of water that's really warm and it doesn't penetrate.
If it crashes in the water, in salt water, they'll keep it in salt water because if they remove it from the salt water, it will immediately begin to corrode the devices inside.
The most common cause of failure is typically due to fire damage.
The Achilles heel of flight recorders is slow heat over a long period of time. So flight recorders can handle a massive amount of temperature and fire for a short period of time, but if you can't find it and it's sitting there smoldering in the ash, then that heat is going to slowly work its way into the unit and melt the solid state circuitry.
In many cases, the recorder itself is not damaged, so we can apply power to it and use some special cabling to connect to it and recover data that way. In a case where they are damaged, though, we have to disassemble the recorder down to what we call the memory board level. And at this point, it's mostly a collection of memory chips. So sometimes it's necessary to solder on new parts or new cables, and then that allows us to communicate with that memory board with some of our surrogate equipment in the lab and download the data like it was a perfectly functioning recorder.
Typically, the black box is two devices, a flight data recorder and a cockpit voice recorder, but many today are in one unit. It's located in the back of the aircraft, as that is considered to be the most crash survivable part of a plane. And some newer planes, like the Boeing 787 Dreamliner, have two with an additional unit in the front of the aircraft.
It's rare where an accident causes so much damage or so much heat that the black box can't be downloaded. Biggest example was 9/11, the two airplanes that hit the Twin Towers. I worked at the Pentagon for the airplane that hit the Pentagon, and the flight data recorder survived, but the cockpit voice recorder, which was an old tape recorded unit, did not survive because it was smoldering in the bowels of the Pentagon for several days. And so by the time we got to it, it was melted.
The recorders turn on when the engines start and off when the engines shut down. They operate in the background unless an indicator light tells the pilot it isn't working.
They're pretty reliable. Every airline checks them periodically, like every day, sometimes every few days.
The maintenance is crucial. So if the box isn't working, you don't have any data. And that's why it's important to periodically test and validate not only that the recorder itself is working, but that the data it's recording is valid and it's accurate.
The underwater beacons on the units have a shelf life of 6 to 7 years. The devices have no memory and record over the previous recording once it reaches the limit of data or audio it can save.
And oftentimes we would lose a lot of that data, either because the airplane wasn't totally destroyed and it got recorded over, or the airplane stayed in the air too long and the event was recorded over.
Most planes can keep 25 hours of thousands of pieces of data, but in some cases, only 2 hours of audio.
So if you have a one-hour flight and you land and then you take off again and fly another 2 hours, it's going to record over itself, after only 2 hours.
Recorders are complicated, but that initial read, which is rough, it's not the most accurate read, but it can give you early directions on what to look for in the on-scene portion of the investigation.
In the event of a crash or incident, and with no significant damage to the memory cards, the NTSB investigators will download the 25 hours of data and 2 hours of audio recordings, then reconstruct the flight in an animation. There is currently no mandate for video recording in the cockpit, so audio becomes even more crucial. One of the new enhancements the Federal Aviation Administration recently mandated is for new aircraft to have 25-hour cockpit voice recorders and suggested older aircraft be retrofitted by 2030. But that has not been finalized yet.
It's easy to design and install a new system on a brand new airplane that's coming out of the factory, but to go back and retrofit hundreds of older airplanes and do the rewiring and everything like that, it's not very cost effective.
During the Alaska Airlines door plug blowout in 2024, the cockpit audio was overwritten and impacted the investigation. The NTSB urged the FAA to update the current fleet to 25 hours of voice recording and highlighted that since 2018, there were 14 investigations where recordings of incidents had been taped over, including a few close calls on runways.
It's just amazing, amazing what they can pick off the recorder. I mean, you talk about black magic. We can tell you if there's something that's broken loose on the airplane that's vibrating.
The flight deck has multiple microphones, including the pilot headsets and an area mic mounted in the panel above where the pilots sit.
We catch it on the voice recorder about fatigue, where the crews may be talking amongst themselves that they're tired. Or we can catch it in their voices if they got plugged up, their noses plugged up, and they really shouldn't be flying.
During the hijacking of United Flight 93 on 9/11, the voice recorder revealed the attempt by passengers to get into the cockpit to stop terrorists before they intentionally crashed the plane. Due to the nature of these recordings, it can be very sensitive to release the actual audio.
No country releases the actual audio recording. Most countries release a transcript. The NTSB does a full transcript.
The audio available from incidents like Miracle on the Hudson are typically air traffic control recordings, which are public. These recordings can also be incredibly useful outside of crash incidents.
One of the most, if not the most expensive component on a modern airplane is the engine. So the data that's on flight data recorders is protected, but we send some of that same data to another unit called a quick access recorder. And what that has done for the people who monitor and design and repair engines is tell them where to look for problems. So we're predicting it, not waiting for it to happen.
Some industry experts are calling for more innovations to these devices.
investigations today are very, very expensive. So any way that we can reduce the cost and time of an investigation is a plus for the whole system.
John Golia led the investigation of TWA Flight 800 that exploded off the coast of Long Island a few minutes after takeoff in 1996. It became one of the largest and most expensive investigations in aviation history.
We spent 2 years out on Long Island, and then there was a crash with US Air in Pittsburgh, Flight 427. That took 5 years.
In some cases, the black boxes are never recovered, like Malaysia Airlines Flight 370. Officials searched for 4 years, but all they found was some debris far from where they thought the plane had disappeared. In other cases, even with the recorders, investigators are still left with questions. The recent Air India crash has renewed the debate on whether or not to have video recorders in the cockpit.
Crash-worthy cockpit video recorders are already being installed in a lot of helicopters and other types of airplanes, but they're not required. There's privacy issues, and there are cost issues. But the NTSB has been recommending that the FAA require them for years now.
There are also new innovations that are being worked on, like real-time feeds from the black box via satellite to the ground. This capability would allow airlines to access data while a plane was still in flight. There are roughly 20 to 30,000 commercial planes in the air at the same time on a daily basis, and sending that much data could pose a challenge.
Just isn't enough server space or memory space to constantly do that. But that is the future of flight recorders, is once you're able to increase that bandwidth and increase that storage, more efficiently process that information, yes, the newer future flight recorders will involve real-time data telemetry as the airplane is flying, and then that telemetry is being archived in a computer somewhere.
Another possibility are deployable recorders, so that when certain parameters are reached and it's certain the airplane is going to crash, the recorder will automatically eject itself, and it will have the ability to float and the ability to send out electronic locating signals so that the box can be found.
Those are all work in progress. We're not there yet on either of those examples.
But again, there's a cost-effectiveness thing there, and is it really worth it? How many accidents could that help? That's something that the FAA struggles with. But the NTSBs, they're all about safety. They're not concerned about how much it would cost. They're all about safety, and that's why they have recommendations on the books for those types of technologies.
Though the black boxes are almost always associated with an aviation disaster, they can bring answers for grieving families, and often solutions so that issues that caused an accident don't happen again.
It's not just the people that were on the airplane are victims, but sometimes the investigators themselves can be victims, because you can't be human and experience what we often see in these mass casualty events in an airplane accident. And I can tell you firsthand that you lay in bed after the accident many, many nights revisiting what you've seen. And it's not nice. Anything that we can do to reduce the need for on-scene investigations, the better off we will be as a society.